Good morning, my friends. We're so glad you've chosen to worship with us today. Whether you're in person or online, we just want to say welcome, and we're glad you're here. I want to remind you all that we have our connection cards available either in the pew in front of you or online. That's how we have the most up-to-date and accurate contact information as possible. And we also have our prayer cards. If you or somebody you know is in need of prayer, fill one of those out, and we pray over those as a staff together every single week. A few announcements before we get started, and the first is that I want to remind all of our pre-K through high school friends that both Spark and Stoke are officially on break for the holidays. We will be back at it after the first of the year, and we will have more announcements of when that is actually going to be when we get closer to it.
Some really exciting news. Officially on January 1st, we are going to be known as Pathway. We are really excited for this transition with you guys, and thank you for being in prayer over the transition. So just keep that in mind as we go into our next year.
We have a ton of very special Christmas services coming up to help us celebrate the season. And it all kicks off on Christmas Eve at 6:45. This is our modern service. We do a lot of really fun, special things there, and we hope to see you there. We also then have our Christmas Eve morning service. This is at 10 o'clock. We're having one combined service, so you either get to sleep in or get up a little extra early. But then we have our 7 o'clock family service and our 11 p.m. candlelight service. These are some of my favorite services we do all year. We hope to see you at one or many of these. And then just a friendly reminder, on December 31st, New Year's Eve, we are doing, again, one combined service at 10 o'clock. So please show up at the appropriate time.
Coming up on January 5th, it's actually the 12th day of Christmas, at 5:30 p.m., we are going to be undecorating the sanctuary, so we're going to be taking everything down. There is a sign-up sheet at the opportunities desk, or you can talk to Keith Foote or the office for more information. That's enough announcements. Let's continue to worship together.
Good morning, church. Ooh, I felt about 30% of that one. Good morning, church. Yes. By the way, I every time this happens, I'm going to keep bringing it up because Will and I made a covenant here in this church that every time he wears a Hawaiian shirt in the video, he holds back the snow. So, Lord, faith of a mustard seed, amen. Thank you so much, Lord, for providing us and reminding us that if we are faithful, you will help us. But this morning, I want you all to feel as blessed. And in less than a week at this point, we're going to be celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ. Are you guys excited about that? That's something that we always need to be reminded because, you know, when we think about the story of our existence, how we were put in this perfect garden and we were put in a world of perfection, and yet we decided to do our own thing. And the Lord said at that moment that you have fallen so far, but yet I have a plan for you. And that plan was Jesus Christ coming to our world, that he'd be born in our sin and our filth and lead us to the light. So that's something that we have to rejoice about. So I want you all to stand with me and join and feel the excitement of the coming and the celebration that we're about to experience soon. Rejoice is the first song we're going to sing. So stand with me, and I hope you feel that same excitement.
Soul and voice, give ye heed to
Christ was born to save. Something that we can always celebrate and be dependent. That's something that, you know, the idea that we can depend on that, because when we think about what we can depend on, every one of us falls short of that idea every single time. But there was something about when God makes a promise and he follows through, it's a guarantee. And the idea that we have this excitement, this ability to rejoice because the King has come. He has come to absolve us from our sins, something that we definitely don't deserve. So this next song that we are going to sing this morning is called The King Has Come. And there's something about being able to recognize that in this world of darkness, somebody came and showed us a light. And the first verse starts with, here and now, light in the darkness, here and now, hope for the hopeless, Emmanuel. Those are the things, those are the reasons why we are here celebrating and worshiping and reminding ourselves of this gift that was given to us.
Hope is life. Hope is.
The King has come and to dwell with us. Father, thank you so much for reminding us that you are the miracle of miracles, that you sent your only begotten Son, that whomsoever believeth within him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Thank you for this gift. Thank you for this promise that you gave us. The moment that we broke our covenant with you, you immediately already knew exactly what needed to be done. And that promise went throughout all time as we continue to fall and suffer and walk away from you. You had a plan and you kept to it, Lord. And that's an example that we will always be grateful for. Thank you for the gift of your Son who watches over our sins. And bless us this morning as we hear your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You all can take a seat. How's everybody doing today? For those that may not know me, my name is Will Flaherty. I'm the Director of Children and Youth Ministry here. At this time, I'm going to dismiss the kids to Children's Church, go with Miss Chris and Mr. Daniel, and hopefully learn a lot, and come back and share with your friends and your family what you learned. While they head out this morning, I'm going to have you guys sit back, relax, and watch a little video. This morning, we're continuing our journey through Advent. We have talked about the hope and the peace that Jesus Christ came to bring. And before I dive into my message this morning, I have some scripture I want to share with you all. And it comes from the book of 1 Peter, chapter 1, verses 3 through 9, and it says this. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is by His great mercy that we have been born again. Because God raised Jesus Christ from the dead, now we live with great expectation. And we have a priceless inheritance, an inheritance that is kept in heaven for you, pure and undefiled, beyond the reach of change or decay. And through your faith, God is protecting you by His power until you receive this salvation, which is ready to be received on the last day for all to see. So be truly glad. There was a wonderful joy ahead of you, even though you must endure many trials for a little while. These trials will show that your faith is genuine. It is being tested in the fire and is purifies gold. Though your faith is much more precious than mere gold. So when your faith remains strong through many trials, it will bring you much praise and glory and honor on the day of Jesus Christ is revealed to the whole world. You love him even though you never see him. Though you do not see him now, you trust him. And you rejoice with the generous and inexpressible joy. The reward of trusting in him will be the salvation of your souls. So like I said, we're continuing our journey through this Advent season. We're continuing our journey toward Christmas. By the way, Andrew kind of already said this, but can anybody else find it hard to believe that we're like a week away from Christmas Eve? Anybody else? It seemed like January was like 2 or 3 weeks ago, and now we're reaching the end of the year. But as we go through our chaotic and hectic and crazy and busy lives, my hope and my prayer for all of us is we can take time during this Christmas season and we can slow down and we can remember why we celebrate this Christmas season. Again, Savannah started us off 2 weeks ago by talking about the hope that often transcends our own understanding that we can look to even when life seems so grim. And then last week, Pastor Dan talked on how Jesus can bring us peace. He can be a refuge for our souls in the storm of life and can bring about a sense of calm. And today we're going to continue on that journey through Advent and talk about how Jesus came to bring us joy. Now, I don't know about you, but this time of year is one of those times where I can look around and I can see so many things that just fill my heart with joy. Whether it's that person that you know that just, it brings them life to bake what seems like 6,000 Christmas cookies every single season. Or it's you finally hear that favorite Christmas song that you've been waiting all year to listen to. Or it's watching that favorite Christmas movie, whether it be It's a Wonderful Life or The Muppets Christmas Carol or Die Hard. Whatever that is that brings you joy. We see that all around. We see it in kids, especially this time of year when they're outperforming in their pageants or just the excitement that they have for this Christmas season. And parents, grandparents, aunts, uncles, when you see that joy well up, especially in little kids, it's infectious, isn't it? You can't help but have a smile on your face. I know when I see my niece running around just yelling the word cow repeatedly, I cannot help but have a smile on my face. But those kinds of joy, those things are happiness. They're a different kind of joy, right? Those are things that very much are of this earth. They're of our world. And they're those things that even though in the moment they can fill us with such excitement and happiness, eventually those feelings are going to fade, right? We're going to forget about those things for a time. But today I want to focus on a different kind of joy. I want to focus on the kind of joy that Jesus Christ came to bring us. Pure, everlasting joy that cannot be taken away from us because it dwells within our very soul. In the scripture I shared with you this morning, it talked about how God came to bring us this sense of joy. He is refining us. He is making us into the man and woman of God that he wants us to be. And he refers to us and as our souls being refined like gold, going through this purification process. When we heat gold, it brings out the imperfections, the impurities, those things that are quote-unquote wrong with us. And it makes it better. It makes it pure. It brings out the full essence of what it's supposed to be. And I love how God refers to this, uses gold in this scripture, how he inspired the author to use this, how he inspired Peter. Because it can be so easy for us to focus on the monetary things in our own life, right? It can be so easy for us to focus on, okay, where's my 401k at? What's the value of my house sitting at? What's the price tag on that thing that I really want to acquire? How do we measure our money? It's the gold standard. But in this scripture, the author says, no, your soul is far more valuable than any amount of gold could ever be. You are so important to God. You are so valuable to God that he, in his wisdom, like Andrew said, from the moment we strayed away from him and said, I have a plan to bring them back to me. And that plan was to send a baby, to send Jesus Christ, God in human form, to this world. He brought joy into the world with his birth. And I love that Jesus came and he lived as a human, right? It can be so difficult for us at times to go, like, I can't begin to think how God thinks because we're trying to think of an infinitesimal and ever-expansing and omnipresent God with our finite brains, right? It's like trying to take a 2-liter and put it in a Dixie cup. It's not going to work. But God had a plan. He wanted to bring us back, and he came to bring us this joy by sending us the gift of his Son. And when we live out our lives, when we truly live the joy of Christ, our lives are different. We sing this time of year about this joy, this unspeakable joy that cannot be contained. And throughout Scripture, we see it all over. Romans 15, 13 says, May the God of hope fill you with joy and peace, and believe that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope, and in this joy you will experience the peace of God. So let it ring forward. Romans 12, 12 says, rejoice and hope, and be patient in tribulation, and constantly praying, again we can rejoice. For we have hope, hope that he offers us. In the book of Philippians, it says, rejoice in the Lord always. I say it again, rejoice. Because no matter what happens in this world, no matter what life seems to throw at us, when life seems to be falling apart, when we are so focused on the darkness and the brokenness of this world, we can rejoice knowing that Jesus Christ came into this world to save all of mankind. We remember the time, this time of year, that a baby was born on a lifelong mission. From the moment Jesus was born, he was on a progression toward his final goal of going to the cross, paying the penalty that we were all supposed to pay, rising victoriously 3 days later, ascending into heaven, and one day he will bring us final victory over sin, over death, over heartache, over sorrow. He came to bring us all of these things. He came so we may live out that truth in our lives, and through that, we may produce the fruits of the Spirit. We may produce love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, self-control. All of these things come forward when we live out this beautiful truth that God came to bring us, right? The Bible says, a bad tree cannot produce good fruit, and a good tree cannot produce bad fruit. So when we live out this life, we will produce this beautiful fruit that God wants us to produce. We will overflow the joy of Christ that comes only from him. You know, in Proverbs 17:22, it says, a joyful heart is good medicine, but a cursed spirit dries up the bones. And isn't that true, my friends? Isn't that something where we've seen people in our own lives when they go through hard times, they react in one or two ways? They're either going to be like, I'm going to succumb to whatever news I just received, or I'm going to exist in the presence of God and live out the most of this. As I was thinking about my message this morning, I thought about two of my own relatives. I thought about my great-grandpa Flaherty, who I never met the gentleman, but by all accounts, good guy. I've heard good stories. But he went in for surgery one day, and while the doctors were performing surgery, they found inoperable cancer. And they closed him up, and they told him in recovery, we could not perform the operation because we have found this. And my great-grandpa Flaherty went, okay, this is how I'm going to go. And he took that diagnosis, and he goes, I'm just going to exist in this. I'm not going to try to fight it. I'm not going to do anything. I'm just going to, this is going to be how I go. And he passed away 3 months later. But I think about somebody else in my family. I think about my grandpa Bug, who some of you might remember still. And he was diagnosed with a disease called non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, which was about, I think, 3 to 5 years he was given before this disease would eventually take his life. And if you knew my grandpa, you know a few things. Number one, he was a man of very, very few words, but when he spoke, you listened. But he was also somebody that found joy in so many of the things in life. He loved spending time with his wife, his kids, his grandkids. He loved always being up on the latest technological advance or gizmo. I remember when my sister got her driver's license, he had 3 GPSs. He was like, pick one. He loved his fishing trips. But he's somebody who found joy in so many of the aspects of life. And he didn't want to lose that. He didn't want to say, this is how I'm going to go. I'm going to fight. I want to experiment so many of the joys of life. And he ended up living for 15 years after his diagnosis. He took what he was told and said, no, this is not going to be the end of it. I am going to continue living the joy of my life. And there's that mindset that God wants us to have in and amongst everything in life that we deal with. We can think to ourselves, how do I continue to lean on God in this? How do I not focus on the negatives of life, but how do I enjoy living every day being the best person that God wants me to be? and not stop until our earthly lives are done here and we go into eternal paradise. My friends, I'm going to be the first to admit that there are going to be times in our life where joy is the farthest thing from our minds, where everything seems to be going wrong. We see people we care about or ourselves struggling, sick, hurting. We see all of these things where every single pitch life seems to throw at us as a curveball. My friends, we know these times. Many of us have experienced these times firsthand. But I'm reminded of probably my favorite verse in Scripture. And I also love the fact this is also my grandmother's favorite verse in Scripture, and we didn't figure that out till after the fact. But it's James 1, 2 through 4, and it says this: whenever troubles come your way, whenever life gets hard, whenever everything seems to be crumbling around you, let it be an opportunity for pure joy. Because when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. So let it grow, so you will be stronger in character and ready for anything. When life is hard around us, remember that we can find joy in the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the one who has already won this battle. And guess what? It is those times in our life where we are leaning on Him, when we have to focus on Him for our sense of joy, that we grow closer to Him. I think about the times in my own life where everything seemed to be falling apart around me, where every life choice I seemed to make seemed to be the wrong one, when every plan I had designed for my own life because I wasn't listening to the one who I should be was crumbling and I felt so alone, or when my parents were going through a divorce and I saw this hurt and this brokenness and this pain that it was being caused. Those were the times in my life where I look back and go, those were the times in my life where I drew closer to God, because that was the only thing I had to lean on. And it's those times that helped make me the person that I am now. Much like the gold that we talked about earlier, our sense of purpose, our sense of hope, our sense of joy is refined through the trials of this world. God is big enough for us to lean on. He is big enough for us to yell at. He has big enough shoulders for us to cry on and listen to everything. So it's in those times where joy is so far from our minds, lean on God, because He is going to help purify and refine you in those times. You know, there's an old anecdote, and I know I've shared it before, but I absolutely love it. And it's such a beautiful image of how we often live with God, of two people walking along a beach. One of those people is us, the other one is God. And when life seems to be going well, we're walking along, you look back, and you see two beautiful sets of footprints in the sand, right? Then those times when life throws these curveballs at us, and as you're walking along this journey of life, feel like everything's trying to drag you down, you look back and you only see the one set of footprints. And it can be so easy for us in those moments to go, God, where were you? I needed you. You weren't there for me. But that is the furthest thing from the truth, because in this story it says, no. God said to the person, those aren't your footprints. They're mine. When you thought nothing was going right, when you thought nobody was there to love you and care for you and support you, I was there carrying you through those times. Those were my footprints. Because we are finite beings. We are small in the grand scope of everything. But the one who created all things said, no. I'm sending my son so that they might be able to experience this amazing joy that can only come from me. This joy that will well up within them, that will overflow out of them and impact people in their world, in their communities, and will change the world for my betterment. Think about this. Have you ever been around a person who has infectious joy? Where they are so happy that you cannot help but have a smile on your face because of the energy that is coming off of them. That is the kind of joy that Jesus Christ came to bring. He asks us to continue on this journey, spreading His love, His peace, His hope, His joy to everyone around us. And what does Jesus Christ want us to do with this amazing gift? Does He want us to put it in our closet and we're not going to look at it for another year until we might have to like think of something for a white elephant gift? No. He says, take this gift I give you. There is no gift receipt. There is no returning it. Take this and give it to the people that need it. Take this joy that I've given you and let it overflow through you.
Because the Son of God came into the world for every single person on this world, whether they ever choose to accept him or not. He gave up his life willingly as a gift for all of mankind so that all might know the love of Jesus Christ. His love overflows from us. It's this beautiful thing that when we are in a relationship with Jesus Christ, it's because someone shared this joy, this love, this peace, this hope, this truth with us. And the only reason that they were able to do that is because somebody shared it with them, and somebody before them shared it with somebody else, all the way back to Jesus. 2,000 years ago, a baby was born in this world, and 2,000 years later, we are still celebrating it because of the truth that it brings. And you never know the impact of sharing the joy of Christ will have on other people. You will never know how the smallest act can change someone's entire day. I wasn't going to share the story, but I'm going to. There have been times in my entire life where things have been rough, where I get inside my own head and I think, why am I doing what I'm doing? I'm not good enough. I'm not doing the job that I'm supposed to be. And it was while I was writing this very message this week that I got a message from somebody on Facebook. And without going into too much detail, it reminded me that me sharing the love of Jesus Christ has an impact on those around me because they were doing the exact same thing. My friends, we have been given this amazing gift to share the love and the hope and the peace of Jesus Christ with other people. We are filled with unspeakable joy, joy that we cannot understand, that we cannot help but celebrate. That is why this Christmas season and all year round is such an amazing thing for anyone who puts their faith and trust and hope in Jesus Christ. Because no matter what the world throws at them, he is a shining light in the darkness. My friends, it is my hope that on this journey that we take together toward Christ, we can share this joy with those around us. We can learn and become better people because of it, and we can grow closer as we celebrate, not just during the Christmas season, but every day of our lives. We can celebrate the hope, the joy, the peace, and the love that Jesus Christ came to bring us. Every day of our lives, because we belong to the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the creator of all things, so that joy might overflow from us and we will be the light that exists in the world because of him. Let's pray, my friends. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we thank you. We thank you that no matter what life throws at us, no matter what is going on, we can exist in your joy. We can exist in this joy that wells up from you, that overflows through us, and that impacts your world. Let us be the ones that are shining that light in your world, not just at Christmas time, but all year round, because you have made all things possible. It is in your Son's holy and precious name we pray. Amen. At this point in our service, we take up an offering. It is your gifts and your offerings and your tithes that allow us to continue to do what we do, to share all of these truths with people in our community. If you have not already dropped off your offering on the way in, you can do so on your way out, or there are ways on the screen behind me that you can also choose to give. Also want to remind you all that after this song, we will be taking communion together. Here in the United Methodist Church, we practice what is called open communion, meaning you do not need to be a member of this church or this congregation. You just want to have a want and desire in your heart to grow closer to Jesus. If you did not pick up a packet on the way in, during this next song, raise your hand and my friend Don will bring some to you. But during this next song, let us prepare our hearts and prepare our minds. Shine across the earth. reason we celebrate this entire time of the season is because God could not imagine eternity without us in it. So he sent his son to live a mortal life on this world because he had a plan. He had a mission to bring us hope and joy and love and peace. And that plan was to make the ultimate sacrifice for every single person on this world. So as we peel back to reveal the wafer, we're reminded that the precious Lamb of God, the unblemished Lamb, the one who lived without sin, his body was broken so that we might experience the joy that comes from a personal saving relationship with Jesus Christ. Let us take and eat and be thankful. And as we reveal the juice, we're reminded that it was the scarlet blood of Christ, the one whose soul was as white as the freshest and cleanest winter snow, that was shed for us, so that our very souls might be refined into the pure gold that God wants them to be. This time, let us take and drink and be thankful. Let's pray. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we thank you. We thank you so much for the plans you have for every single person. God, we ask you to remind us that you are with us when life throws us curveballs. And let us not exist in the temporary joys of this life, but the everlasting and eternal joy that comes only from you. And let us be wellsprings of that truth in our world, in our schools, in our homes, in our places of work, and in our communities, because you have done so much for us first. And as together all God's people said, amen.
Amen. It's such a wonderful time to celebrate this holiday. And as we go from this place, let us feel that within us, that spirit, that joy, that love, that wonderful miracle that we have. Stand with me as we close this service with what a glorious night. It's a joy and a wonderful feeling to remember how important that first night was when Jesus was born.
Hallelujah, the baby, praise him again. high. Below in Bethlehem, the King is sleeping. Oh, what a glorious night. Oh, what a glorious night.
Happy Sunday.